Hey everyone, and welcome to Go See 3. My name's Brian Campbell, and I'm the tree science lead for the NASA Globe Observer. And I am based at the NASA Wallops Flight Facility in Wallops Island, Virginia, in the United States. At NASA, we have a satellite called the Ice Cloud and Land Elevation Satellite 2, or ICESAT 2. Even though its primary objective is to look at the melting ice in the polar regions on the planet, it has a laser altimeter on board so it can measure the height of objects on Earth, including trees. We love this satellite because it gives us this third dimension that we haven't seen from space before. So it provides us with this height data, and it's very important for us understanding our planet's tree height structure as well as biomass. One of our major goals with the tree height observations is to combine the NASA Globe Observer Trees Tool data with the space-based data from NASA. So we decided to publish a paper with this information where we were looking at Globe Observer data from two specific locations where we saw a lot of data coming in, Grand Mesa, Colorado, and Greenbelt, Maryland. We also were able to use data from students in New York about assessing the variability across these volunteers and the potential impact of user error on height measurements. Since release of the NASA Globe Observer Trees Tool on 26 March 2019, we have had observations from over 100 countries. There were 52,000 tree height observations from Globe volunteers such as yourself. So, scientists can use your tree height data that you're taking with the NASA Globe Observer Trees Tool as Globe volunteers. Here what you see, there's a lot going on in this picture. But what's great about this is showing you how we can do comparisons between the ICESAT 2 data and the NASA Globe Observer data. I did a data comparison in Salisbury, Maryland, where ICESAT 2 measured the tree canopy at 19.66 meters. I went outside and took an observation with the NASA Globe Observer Trees Tool, and I got 18.93 meters. Very close. So this is something we want to do. We want to build up a data set for student and professional researchers to use. We have ground-based data from Globe, and we have space-based data from NASA. And when we combine these, we can get a tremendous data set for research.
Hello, everybody. My name is Marile Colon Robles. I'm the project scientist for NASA Globe Clouds. And we match every possible observation that you record using the Globe Observer app to satellite data. And here are all the different satellites that we match your cloud observations to. And with that data that we've collected from you, thank you so much, we just put out, this is our most recent research paper. It goes into looking at the differences and similarities between your ground observations to satellite data during some, not all, but some of those data challenges that we've done in the past. Number one is that your observations actually match really well with satellite data. So when we and the research team that put together this paper looked at total cloud cover all around the world and compared it to all those satellites that we match your observations to, the results are within 10%. That is amazing, okay? And so then when the team looked into differences when you report high clouds, mid-level clouds, and low-level clouds, that's when differences started popping up. But not just between you and the satellites, between the satellites themselves. So again, this is why we are so thankful for your observations and why it's so important to always keep getting observations. Satellites are great, but they're not perfect. So in this study, we deep dive into when do the certain satellites differ from each other and also from your ground reports. And some of the things that we found is because of the opacity or how thick those clouds are can create those discrepancies or differences. So those thin high clouds particularly are hard for certain instruments on some of these satellites to detect. But our eyes, if we're able to detect them or see them in clear days when there's no low-level clouds, we can detect them really well. The second Thing that we've noticed is that your observations are actually really, really good. So 10% difference, when there is a difference, it's not just between the ground observations and the satellites themselves differ between each other. So we go into that, but also your robustness. And so meaning how many data points, how many of these observations do we need worldwide to have really good statistics? And we don't need that many. Of course, as more as we have per location, the better. But it just shows how good your observations are. Now, other things that we've done or we found with your observations is that we are really close, about to reach our 1 million satellite match. And maybe as the time we see this video, we have reached the 1 million satellite batches. So that is huge. Again, the more data that we have, the better the statistics and the research that we can do. So thank you for that. It doesn't mean that we stop here. We continue. So keep continuing those observations throughout. And throughout this year, we've seen some really neat observations, including volcanic eruptions, over water observations in the polar regions, which are hugely unique and rare to get. And then observations again when it's cloudy and things are happening on the ground, like in this time in Australia, where a Habuba dust storm was reported but not detected by the satellites. So again, your observations always matter. And then what happens to your photographs? We launched this project, NASA Globe Cloud Gaze, in 2021. It's on the Sooniverse online platform, and we are looking at what are the types of clouds and cloud cover that you can notice in your own photographs. We invite you into that, and we're using this data for machine learning purposes. So again, using your observations and research. So on behalf of the NASA GlobeClouds team, we are delighted to be reporting all these ways in which your observations are used in research. Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Peter Nelson, and I'm the science lead for NASA's Globe Observer's Land Cover Tool.
We have now, together as a community, mapped 18,000 unique locations, which is something that hadn't really happened before, and not one single person can do on their own. And this has been done over 25,000 times. So we do have a lot of locations that are doing repeat observations, which is really, really incredible to see, because that's where we can do neat science like change over time and some other interesting pieces like that. And I want to highlight quickly a few of those projects and some of the results that have happened. But do take a look at this page, because the science behind what we're doing sometimes might not be obvious to you. And it's becoming really exciting to see dynamic features like ice, something that we can actually capture with these photos. And so a group of researchers and community members have come together to use Globe Observer's Land Cover Tool to monitor something dynamic like ice that can actually change on a day-to-day, hour-by-hour basis like this. And to combine it together with the satellite imagery is really exciting. So look for some wonderful results from what they're doing. We've been able to actually publish peer-reviewed journal articles that, again, help us to be part of that larger science conversation. And so this is something that we look forward to doing more of, and we hope that people will not only take the data as it is, but do some really interesting science and build some methodology, new methodology, using the data that we collect. Because the data can also inform and be used in research. And so not only have the methods been discussed out there in a peer-reviewed article fashion like this, but students have contributed to collecting and publishing data. And that all can help inform some of the other interesting things that are happening out there in science conversations, because land cover is interesting by itself, but it gets really much more interesting when you reach out to other communities, because land cover is foundational to mosquito habitat, for instance. So we've been working together to support many of the observations and the research involved around the mosquito habitat mapping program within Globe Observer and also other programs outside of the Globe program. We really want to highlight that starting shortly here, we are going to have this land cover challenge where we're going to focus on different land cover types and making sure that we get observations and examples of those from around the world. We have this wonderful opportunity with new land cover maps, new science that is happening out there and doing visualizations and bringing this data together. So thank you so much for joining us in what we've been doing the last couple of years with the Globe Observer's land cover tool, and join us in our upcoming land cover challenge.
Hi, I'm Rusty Lowe, reaching you from my own personal mosquito habitat in the beautiful Rocky Mountains near Boulder, Colorado. I'm the science lead for the Globe Observer Mosquito Habitat Mapper. You're contributing to research in a big way. I wanted to show you two papers that have come out in the last year. The first one is looking at the Globe Mosquito Habitat Mapper's citizen science data up to 2020. And the second one was a paper that just came out 2 days ago, where we are talking more about all the different ways in which this data is being used by scientists around the world. Most important thing, all of our papers that are coming out from Globe Observer are saying the authors are gratefully acknowledging all the contributions of you in this research. You can find these publications here, download them and read them if you like. You know that mosquitoes are important. And one of the reasons they're important is not just disease, but they're also telling us about climate change. Mosquito seasons are starting earlier, ending later. Hitchhiking species are coming to new regions, and the ranges are expanding as climate warms. And the monitoring that you're doing on the ground with mosquitoes are helping us to better understand these three ways that our mosquito landscape is changing. The map is now being used by community entomologists in Ethiopia to identify locations of a dangerous recent invasive mosquito vector. This little guy is called Anopheles stephensi. He is a very, actually it's a she because the she's the biters, right? She is a very dangerous mosquito because she also breeds in containers. That completely changes the landscape and the demographic of where and when we're fighting mosquitoes. So we have a big team now. It is a team looking at AI. They are using your photographs in order to identify this dangerous species in Africa. And I want to let you know that this is the most exciting thing I think that's happened, because you never know when your data is going to be useful. So in 2020, one of you citizen scientists reported this mosquito in Madagascar in a tire. Now, most malaria mosquitoes are found in standing water, in ditches, and in water bodies, and in wetlands, but not in tires. So we found that the habitat, we found that mosquito, and based on the AI that we have been working on at the University of South Florida, it looks like this might be the first appearance of this particular mosquito in this area. So your data is being used for the development of AI. Citizen scientists are producing a lot of data that can be used in this way. And when you take these 9 photos, that helps us to do this AI research. So most people just do one photo, but go ahead, move your mosquito around, give us different angles. Be sure to give us information about the head, the thorax, and the abdomen, and include all the hairs in your observations. Finishing up with some beautiful pictures submitted by a citizen scientist of some eggs, of a pupa, and of an adult. And we look forward to seeing your observations and your photos in the database. Thank you for all you've done. Thank you for all the data. Thank you for being part of really important research about changes that are happening on our planet and how those changes are impacting global health.